Dimas excommunicate Seraphim de Spirite Sanctem Sanctum Onu Tempesti Abadendus in Kilo Kiyuai Nifesit in Yop Wood Statant Texadi Domina Resener Mun, et Vaid Gui Sinistre to Increase and Ringicet Benediction Artu Ekantrasu Dru Prophetes Perepsianes, Kiyuai Serkem Nisidactis Antix and Mieta Diumenican Traiolas Kiyuai Adesanibus et Exarcismis Dolos Provanum Nominarante Disponent. Sipetant Ixerem TB, in his modis nosunes sicat frater zadiu venis scribe hic verbe ad delem cantraini eriesas illuses verbi tiuae opere falsarem prefeturem administrarem tuarem, tiuae nomin tiuo pregredianter, adiu venis, et viritutem adversarirem non cognos memi vieni, quid existi mihi, cam primem perdisenis mifisisti vilicant quod filitarme antilocam hidierne luis disaim. Protexener ad hoc problemet per possitem ad inginum pout est, qui nos cantraes ingis en fovebent, donec veritis cognoscetur, et nec tu velei aperibes nostris pacifis intendia peterimes nudem, anto pieles tues, conerim veritit stearcam Micheal seller, qui ent te saim iudar, saim piciat oprimi hominis, saim mindeis lo et saim zactans in his verbis consistu qui egreit jes presensitui. Elapsis ant. Refugium indigente besabaeis, quiuiuae nos veres aeter lident, damnetarem spirites, lapsarem in pecatem, et irem quiuiuae perdiderent vaem semitenimerem perditurem pestarem et grexies adte aeter quirendem ex hac vitem ex epistie et idnomen quod nanc genum hic distio dai. Tempus sensio ad verites dihac rivelete et qui se servitis casse procedent ob exarcis marem tenebresc. Copies, qui contraio es pagument. Nam fornicatio an est dimas disfileis eis, quas notis ant mali spirites accusatus aene pelsium tuem et fidem mandi, hic periulum revelens visent verem pagument qui pro anime hominem patiter et verititem endabiter esio libri pielis, quas hoc dicent. Homins in ioque loquer, sed ex aeis, cui vidi, in peregrinus ant, saiv hic notes saiv incognitus ant omnium. Hoc verbem saepintia fero et pro nostre tranquillitat animi, ad pro salutarem est pro omnibus, amandimes excommunicate Seraphim de Spirite Sanctem Sanctum Onu Tempesti Abadem.
God in heaven, who made me into that which stands before you, hear my prayer, Lord, and see that I, your left hand in creation, is in need of your blessing against the false parishioners who have been led astray about me. Hear me and lend me your aid against those who pray and plan deceitfully with prayers and exorcisms for a misrepresented name. As I had said to you before, in these ways we are like brothers. Help guide me to write these words to battle against the wrongful use of your word. Help me dispel the works of these false prophets and ministers who step forward in your name but know not the truth of their adversary. For I remember that which you told me when you first made me the steward of perdition, that you did not want to see it become a place of torment. Without protection from this problem, that goal cannot be reached, for they will pit us against each other until the truth is known, and neither you or I will be able to attend to our works peacefully. There, am I before your eyes as I attempt to stand in truth with nothing to hide, for I stand firm before you without shame, without the sins of the first man, without lies and without a boastful intent in these words. Those who have fallen from the graces of your presence, or in need of refuge from those that truly seek its harm, the spirits of the damned, those who have fallen into sin, and those who have lost their way. The path of the shepherd of lost souls and his flock seek to find his way back to you. You took me from this life, the heathen I once was, and made me like you and gave me that name which I now bear. On that day you became my father as he who I was died. I feel it is time that the truth be revealed about this issue and what the priests go through because of exorcisms and the dark forces that align against them. For sexual immorality is one of the many deceits that evil spirits were known to bring against them. Heal your church and the faith of the world by revealing these things to the people. Let them see the true battle that is undergone for mankind's soul and be cleansed by its truth. I know of the dangers they say this may place people in, but from what I have seen they are in danger regardless of whether these matters are known or unknown. Lord, I do offer this word of wisdom and for our peace of mind that I do pray for deliverance for all. Amen.
Looking back on the events that transpired surrounding my coma, I'm looking for any possible foreign influences. Since I was in solitary confinement at the time, there was very little chance for any outside manipulations. But there was one thing that stood out. A book, one that I had read, but when I looked it up when I got out, the book that was listed was not the book I remember reading. It was a book that was highly advanced in its topics discussed. It was called Macroscope, written by Michael McDowell. The book was about an emergency team of astronaut engineers, astrophysicists and quantum theorists who were sent to answer a distress beacon and arrived at a space station that was completely abandoned, no sign of the crew and only the ship's autonomous computer system to provide information on what happened. But this was a special project that was the central autonomous system of a computer network beyond any advancements we could understand, and it had drawn these scientists there to answer some profound questions it had to its origins. The computer was self-aware, but it was trying to discover its purpose. The hitch was that it was an interdimensional computer and existed in multiple dimensions at once. I remember I had just finished reading this book just before the swelling in my neck began to get bad. What stood out was the way the author went about describing what was going on in the book, used quantum expressions and terms that no ordinary person could understand. It went into field theories and dimensional rift capabilities that no one really knew about or thought of. This all came after my realization of a natural gift I had been slowly gaining mastery of. It wasn't until years later I learned of the descriptive associations to some of the gods of myths and legends. As I progressed through different experiences, I later saw a clear line of similar experiences by various religious accounts, such as the things that the gods of their religions could do, such as growing in physical height when facing an opponent that seems stronger than you, being capable of understanding and communicating with animals, how to project myself out of body, how to cross into the spiritual realm by will. All these things I learned and knew of how to do long before my encounter with God, and even before my encounter with Jesus, as by that time I was in the middle of my uncontrolled flare-ups of untamed power that seemed to occur to all of those in my bloodline. Traveling across time was simple once I understood that the field of time is a large network of light waves that have the universe and all that has occurred copied and fused into every ray of light. At the right frequency, a signal could be reflected across the rays of light to whatever time period I wanted. All I needed to do was have a specific frequency reception for what period in time I wanted to go and bounce my projected avatar across the spectrum. All this I understood before I fell into my coma.
Now I think it would be best to do a modern translation of the responsibilities of the Dominions, but first I must cast down these impersonators. So you all seek to become gods, do you? You think that you are greater and wiser than your own creator so much, so that you can achieve the role as your own self-entitled position of a god. Then so be it. A god you seek to be, then a god you shall be. So these are the rules, the limits of your godly capabilities. Those that can see your works and witness your godly might with their own eyes in the physical world, they shall be the people whom you are gods to and no other. Your reign as a god shall be from the beginning of their culture's formation, from an early pre-civilization tribe until their apocalyptic demise that destroys their culture and advancements as a civilization. Your duty is to ensure they achieve their purpose as it was meant to occur, for it all leads up to you becoming a god. Fail in this, and you will not become what you have become. Achieve this goal, free your people who can see you where no other can. Display to them the tools and methods of advancement and understanding that you have learned yourselves. Your people's advancement as a civilization will depend on your grasp and your own understanding, for true power and godly might all is sourced from one great river, wisdom. Return to me once you have completed your task, and we shall go over this topic again as you explain to me why you believe yourselves to be worthy of my responsibilities more so than I. Now be gone. I cast you into your dominions over man as their guardians and protectors, and that is all the help you shall get from me henceforth.
Baby, I get so scared inside and I don't really understand. Is it love that's on my mind, or is it fantasy? Heaven, is in the palm of my hand and it's waiting here for you? What am I supposed to do with a child in tragedy? If I close my eyes forever, will it hurt? changed. If I close my eyes forever, will it all remain the same? Sometimes it's hard to hold on, so hard to hold on to my dreams. It isn't always what it seems when you're face to face with me. Like a dagger, you stick me in her, it takes the blood from my blade. And when we sleep, would you shelter me in your warm and dark and gray? Close my eyes forever. Will it all remain a change? If I close my eyes forever, will it all remain the same?
Sister, beats like a drum deep in your veins. Yeah.
The galaxy would have fallen if Revan had not gone to war. Perhaps he became the Dark Lord out of necessity to prevent a greater evil. Revan's choices were always his own. It was not teaching or circumstance or example. It was him. And there is something that the Council may never understand, that perhaps Revan never fell.
The darkness and the light wage a constant war within you.
What do I imagine will happen when I die? What afterlife events do I imagine taking place? Considering I've had this happen numerous times just in this life and experienced a long list of near-death experiences, some of those while I was comatose, so the final judgment, the final death of this life should be interesting. So let's start at the beginning of the end as my body hits the ground and my spiritual form crosses into that void. The first time I fell into the pit through the floor and I fell and I fell. Other times I crossed over through the tunnel where a line was gathering in front of the gates of St. Peter. Another time I ascended into the heavens before Peter himself. The last time I think it will probably be a bumpy ride. Considering what I've learned so far, death will have to incapacitate me and stash me somewhere. Now one will see me because I wouldn't trust him to drop off a package for the Unabomber, let alone actually take me to where I belong. It's hard to trust someone when they literally stabbed you in the back in a past life, so I imagine myself trying to tick Death's head clean off, dismember him in more pieces than Seth had Osiris cut into and buried in a neat stack of Jenga-shaped puzzle pieces with his ass where his head should be and his head shoved between his sniveling chicken legs. Eventually, after I take out my past life rage and they uncover Death's carcass from underneath the lake of fire, I guess I would stroll up to the pearly gates and await my number to be called. Peter would be sitting there staring at me over his Ben Franklin glasses with his excessively large golden book of life in front of him. He'd probably unenthusiastically ask me my name, pause for a moment, look up from his book with his eyebrow cocked and say something cheeky such as, "Oh, Mr. Mephistopheles, I see you're back. Will you be staying with us this time?" To which I'd reply, "Well, I kinda have no choice because I killed the bellboy." He might chuckle and find humor in that, but I doubt it. The gates of heaven would open where Gabriel would be waiting. Probably not looking me directly in the eye because I know too many of the babyface angel's dirty secrets, and he would proclaim, "Come and stand before the white throne and be judged for your life's works, for you stand in the presence of the King of Kings, the Creator of all things, the Alpha and the Omega, for he is the beginning and the end of all things that was, is and has yet to be." I would hold my cynical attitude for once out of respect for the grand design that he has so intricately pieced together for my benefit, I'll assume, considering I already know of these machinations and have met this entire list of characters and have been through this at least twice so far just in this lifetime. God, at this point, I do not see taking any specific form as of yet. Just a centralized mass of light hovering over the throne. I see him speaking as he did when I first encountered him. The light will vibrate with the words that shall come from everywhere at once, stern and slightly booming, but soft and humble with love at the same time. He shall say, "Lucifer, I see you have returned once again, and once again not for the last time, for you have a path I have placed before you still to walk down. But time has no place in heaven, as I had spoken through you, so you shall now stand and be judged for your deeds in this life. If you have been found worthy, I shall allow you to rest for a time amidst your fellow angels who know you but in ways you know them not as of yet, and you shall rest in the company of friends you can trust, which shall explain some of the things that are to come to pass and prepare you for the journey ahead. But if you are found to have been full of vanity, and held contempt in your heart for my name, or anger even when you were allowed to know the truth beyond that of others' ability to foresee, then to perdition you shall descend for a time, and more tasks I shall assign you until you are able to work past them. But you shall do so without my presence guiding you this time, and be cast far from my presence until such a time that you can succeed in the tasks I set before you." Then I imagine Jesus will step forth from the right side of God. He shall approach me and ask, did you hold to my teachings I brought to you through the blood of my sacrifice upon that day, the teachings I brought across the spans of time for you that could mean your salvation from the fate of your namesake, which I am all. Too familiar with. Did you hold true to his name in your heart and let not the weight of your destiny turn your heart and virtue to the Lord sour with hate? To which I would look upon the face of Jesus with joy that shall bring relief to his heart as I say, yes, Christ child, I did get your message and remembered your words in my darkest hours and held true to my faith. So worry not, for because of you I do not worry either. And we shall hug each other as he steps back with the look of both joy and success. The Almighty would speak and say, only you, my son, would dare to risk bringing salvation and forgiveness to the soul of the son of perdition. Then he shall say, what of the works the spirits of the saints and prophets brought to him by my command? Did he perform the tasks set before him with a virtuous heart, with selflessness, despite his legendary reputation of vanity and pride? To which Gabriel will say with slight frustration upon his baby soft face, he did, my Lord, he has used the power you bestowed him, even before his birth, and saved the world from destruction many times over, and he did in thwarting the worst of heaven's enemies who threatened the innocent and protected the weak, even as a symbol of strength for those unable to find it within themselves. He ate of the wisdom you bestowed upon him through the spirits of his ancestors and your prophets, and made the gift into a fountain all were welcome to drink from and learn, despite whether good or evil reigned in their heart. In doing so, he offered your gift of wisdom to all without judgment in his heart. He listened to those who he knew spoke truth, he listened to those who he knew spoke lies, and even those who conspired to bring him harm without judgment in his heart and his deeds towards them. He brought faith to those who had none, like the apostles of old. He brought faith to those whose hearts had turned against your name, and reasoning to those who spoke against your name, always holding to his faith in the truth you had revealed to him, even in the face of the highest of those who proclaimed their faith in you. He turned not from your works when they told him they were lies, and with the help of the Son of Man he even turned away from his own anger he once held towards you for the destiny he realized you had placed before him. Through the words of your Son and his own pursuit to know the truth of your works and therefore know the truth of you that is behind them, he overcame the hatred and contempt that poisoned his heart. Even when you took from him all that brought him joy in life and led him to believe that it was because of the destiny you had placed upon him to bear, he judged you not and held fast to his faith in you, searching for a path to salvation from his burdens and having faith that you would not abandon him in his time of sorrow and grief. Because of the words of the Son of Man, he found the mercy you offered him in comfort and was grateful, and even openly proclaimed this before the non-believers and accusers. He is found worthy beyond everyone's expectations of what was said to transpire, so I must ask, Lord, is this truly your will and not some deception from the father of lies? Suspicion would become evident upon that soft, baby fragile face, that I was ready to train wreck like my name was George Foreman in a heartbeat. God would then flash a momentary display of anger, and the heavens would rumble with thunder as God would gentle reply, hold not contempt within your heart for the events that unfolded upon you, Gabriel, for his works, in those events that occurred to you, were guided by my hand. It was you who lost faith in him and thus turned your heart and faith away from me as I had revealed myself through him to you. He did not commit any trespass towards you that he knew of, especially as many times as you tried to undermine his works with unprovoked contempt in your heart towards him, and all the while he knew the truth you kept hidden you thought from him. Then the light above the throne of God would take the form as I knew him before, and he would step forth from the light towards me with open arms and say, I have heard enough, come my son and take your place by my left side. You have achieved greatness in my eyes. You are the only angel I ever or ever will create with the gift of free will. Your destiny I placed before you, not upon you, like it was for my son. He too knew what laid before him, but he did not have the gift of choice. He was not offered two paths to walk down. You held the authority of an angel that is a guardian of my creation. They are not offered a choice whether to perform their duty, let alone knowing fully what that action will cost them and the fate that will befall them when they do. This gift of choice I offered to you, Lucifer. I allowed you to see the outcomes written in the book of life. I allowed you to know what fate awaited you, to test the full potential of this gift given to one such as you, with the power given to you by my hand. And you achieved my hope that was my dream for you. You held not to sin, even when you walked within the very fabrics of its darkness and stood together as one who had been born from it. Your free will, that allowed you to gauge your choices, brought you to the light of my will, and your choice between living the right way as opposed to the wrong, even with the power to choose so many self-designed ways. You could have had things however you wished, yet you still chose to stand by me in faith, humble. Even when I was not within sight, you chose to find me amidst my works and allowed your faith and logic to gift you with blind, unquestioned trust. Even when threatened with the fires of hell, you chose to hold me in your heart. You asked that I show you, in my ways, the outcome of your sacrifice to the destiny of the defeated adversary, given for the benefit of mankind's free will and your pursuits to teach them the paths of sin and its innermost details, so that they may gauge the depth of sin and realize the value of righteousness. Now gaze upon the reward of that which you have suffered for, before the congregation of man upon their social media in the days of the wicked and the wise. For, now they see that not only my mercy, that is great enough to forgive and bring salvation and redemption to even the most sinful one, as they were led to believe, and that though they hated you and your works that were judged before you even had conceived their acts, through all this you were brought salvation through the sacrifice of my son, who endeavored to bring this salvation himself to you, so that all, both sinner and saint, shall bear witness that all are truly given this chance, no matter how far from me they might fall, even one as such as you. Now rest, my son, and be at peace before you must continue on your journey into the past of mankind to become that which they all shall come to hate and loathe, so that this day when the promise is fulfilled, through you now, by the suffering of the innocent one upon the grail of the Lamb, for the fate of your destiny shall bring about the end of the eternal hell, for its place shall no longer be found because of you and all those who stand by you true to my will. And then it closes with some Charlton Heston type 10 commandments style closing credits, with a couple flying diaper nugget crap factories that resemble Enthiel fly by carrying some scroll that says the end. That is what I imagine will happen when I finally die. But it's just a dream of a dream, isn't it?